Signori, buonasera. Benvenuti alla Casa Italiana Zerini Marimodera, New York University. We are delighted to be here tonight and to have a full house for what has become a sort of an appointment with the music of Roberto Scarcella Perino. As you know, Roberto Scarcella is a member of the faculty here in the Department of Italian Studies, and is also our composer in residence. So this appointment also serves to make the point of where Roberto is at in his composing career. And this year there are several very important things, one of which you just saw from this beautiful news service from the Italian news channel TG2, and I had the fortune to be in Città della Pieve last summer when his opera premiered, and it's a jewel of an opera. So it was an undertaking that could make many people tremble, because nobody in the history of opera ever dared to translate into music the work by Ludovico Ariosto, Orlando Furioso, that is notably the longest poem in the history of Italian literature. Roberto did. Other minor composers before him that will go unmentioned decided to concentrate on one scene or one episode of the Orlando Furioso, and that was enough to fill an opera. And I have to say, it's 2 hours that go like a breeze, because the beauty of the music and the different styles of music that Roberto is able to incorporate in his opera make for a wonderful, wonderful musical experience. And the production, you saw it, like there were young people from 22 different countries, all speaking in Italian. The libretto is in Italian. I love the fact that Roberto basically was the only man in the group that was otherwise made of women, the conductor, the librettist, and the director of the opera. And he went perfectly well, and everybody loved him, of course. What I can say is that I would really like, and with me so many other people, would really like to see this opera on a stage in the United States very soon. And we're going to do anything we can to help it out. And I hope we can enlist each and every one of you seated here tonight in this endeavor. This is what we really should aim to by the next year. To have, I'm not saying the opera on stage, but to have a commitment from some theater that the opera is coming to the United States. There is so much need for new, beautiful opera music, and to bring to the States also with the opera of Roberto the tradition and legend of the Italian epic poem of the Renaissance with Ariosto. So please help us make it a priority to support this composer to bring his operas to the States. It was beautiful in Città della Pieve. I can only think that it would be better in one of the stages here in New York City. So help us with that. The other major thing that Roberto did this past year was a short opera called La Scolta, based on a libretto by poet Gian Maria Novi. And it premiered last summer at Villa La Pietra, that is, as you know, the New York University Estate in Florence, where Roberto and I have the fortune of teaching every summer. That was a very, very moving experience, very different style compared to the one that we saw in Furiosos, but a level of refinement, both musical and poetic, that is very rarely seen. And I'm not saying this because of the bias for my friendship and respect and admiration for Roberto. No, La Scolta is really something that you should all experience. And I think there are excerpts of it online, right, Roberto? Of La Scolta. And of course, there is the Piano Sonata Number 3 that Roberto just composed. It's the first time that it's performed in the U.S. I think it was performed in Russia last spring, and it's part of the program that we're going to listen to tonight, along with Piano Sonata Number 2 and a few other pieces that Roberto composed for the piano. Once again, I would like to thank our friend and board member Paolo Martino for the donation of this beautiful Yamaha piano. Paolo, unfortunately, cannot be here with us tonight. But one of the reasons he bought and donated the piano to the casa in memory of his wife, Lilia Werner, was to give a beautiful voice to the music composed by Roberto. He did it also for him. So we thank Paolo, we thank Roberto, and I'm inviting you to welcome to the stage very warmly our composer in residence, Maestro Roberto Scarcella Perino. Thank you.
you for coming. The concerts will be me and the piano, the relationship that I had all my life with this instrument. And I want to tell that, of course, a lot of the people that came tonight, or friends and their colleagues, they always ask me, are you playing tonight? And I said, no, I'm not playing. And but I'm going to tell you a little story about me and the piano. It starts when I was born. So when I was born, and I was born in an apartment, everybody, like not everybody knows, but I was born in the kitchen. And I looked around, there was no piano, so when I started to ask for a piano, when I was six, my parents started to ask all my relatives, because all my relatives had a piano, just us with a piano. So my grandfather, Nonno Peppino, Giuseppe, Nonno Peppino from my mother's side, he had this amazing piano. It was a concert piano, Graham Coda, a Bechstein. The offer to give me like this piano, I was six, so I was excited about it. But there was no space, because I had to share my bedroom with my brother, so there was no way that I could have that piano. But the other grandmother, and from the father's side, Nonno Pippo and Nonna Pippa, Giuseppe, my friend. They offered their piano. There was another kind of piano. Was a huge piano. It was a pianola. Maybe some of you know what this is. A player piano that play with a roll. You have the pumps and that you activate with the feet. So the music start to roll and the keyboard move by itself. So it was very old, from the 18th century, that survived to the earthquake in Messina, to the World War I, World War II, survived also to my grandma, that had a very strong personality. But this piano was like really something, you know. It was, I could remove the keys, and I was writing all the name, the notes. There were like two candlesticks around that I would candles that I was not allowed to use, and lots of boxes. I remember I could open like this piano everywhere and hide everything there. Like, so this is my point. Because of this piano, I could become a composer, but not a concert pianist. So this is the point of my story. So tonight we have a pianist that will play my music. That is Giuseppe Bruno. Giuseppe Bruno, another Giuseppe. my life is full of Giuseppe. Giuseppe Bruno and I, we met in 1999 in Pisa. We had a performance. I wrote this opera, Cavaldonato, my first opera. And this opera was performed in Pisa with 100, there were 100 kids performing on stage. In the audience, they were in the orchestra playing, plus professional singers and professional orchestra player there. So Giuseppe Bruno had to conduct everybody with a hat that was spinning, like an exorcista. So then I thought, Giuseppe is not going to play my music again. But instead, he started to ask me, you know, to play my music, and so I sent my music to him, and I can tell that Giuseppe is the main ambassador of my music, because he's playing everywhere, like when he has the chance to play my music. And this not only for the friendship that we have. Tonight, plus, is a special night because it's Giuseppe Bruno's birthday. When I told him, you know, the only day available is February 9th, and he said, "Why? This is the great way to celebrate my birthday." birthday, so I'm glad that he's playing this birthday instead of answering to messages by Facebook and everything is here. So the program of tonight. The program of tonight is going to be first. We have you can see the program turning in a weird way. the first piece is going to be Constellations. Constellations is inspired by the constellation, the summer constellations. Is a piece that is a suite, is a ballet that I it was a commission that I wrote for Ardionnax Ballet. And this starts with a prologue and finish with a finale, and there are all the names of the constellation one after another. The idea was to write the drawing of the constellation on the score, on the staff. So one example, Cassiopeia is the W, if you know the constellation, Cassiopeia is the shape of the W. So when I was writing on the score, it was pom, 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 it was the shape of the W. So all of them, they begin with the drawings on the, plus there is the personality. So each one lasts 1 minute, so they're very short. The first and the last are the same. And lots of people that listen to Constellation, they always tell me I could understand the eagle, aquila, then I could understand the dolphin, then I got lost. So don't worry if you get lost, because it's what you do when you watch up at the sky, the stars. So it's, if you don't follow anything like that is happening, it's going to be. The second piece is the Sonata number 2. Sonata number 2 is dedicated to a very close friend of mine that is here tonight, Patrizia, Patrizia Di Carrocchio. Of course, we have an applause because Patrizia is one of the most generous person. No, like she's not only generous; she's a giver. Not only of her heart, her time. So for me, when happened that was her birthday, she said something really beautiful. She said, "I don't want any gift. I want emotions." So So I ran home, I collected my emotions, and I decided to write the emotions in the shape of the piano sonata number 2. So this is her piece. The other one, the sonata number 3, we didn't say tonight, is dedicated to the person that is very famous inside of these four walls, in New York. And it's Stefano Bertini. It's not only written for him, but it's also inspired by him. In fact, it's not an easy sonata. When Giuseppe Bruno was studying this sonata, after 6 months I was practicing, she would tell me, maybe I understood the code to of the interpretation of the sonata. So I thought, oh my God, this is a very intellectual sonata. And then I thought, of course, you know, because it's inspired by Stefano. Because of Stefano, so it's very fine. The movement are 3 is going to be a U.S. premiere. It was premiered in Russia, it's true, but I have no idea because I wasn't there. There is not a recording of the performance. So for me, this is actually the real premiere of the sonata. And this sonata is in 3 movements. The first is Allegro ma non troppo, because when I was hired at NYU with Stefano, we decided to have a chorus with the Italian students, and the name was Gli Allegri ma non troppo. So the first one is Allegro. The second one is un valzerino, and valzer della bassa, so the valzer mazurka is a dance that's usually in all like Parma and also Modena, they used to dance, and they still dance and they love to dance. And the last movement, Vivacissimamente, that is a There are two styles, like the American style and rhythm and melodies, and the Italian at the same time. So last piece tonight that will be performed is 12 variazioni su Churi Churi. Churi Churi, if you are Sicilian, think that is your hymn, like the Sicilian hymn, is a famous song. It's actually a sad song with the lyrics, because it's saying Churi Churi, Churi tutto l'anno, l'amore che mi dasti ti ritorno. That in dialect means all the love you gave me, I'm going to give it back to you. But the music is kind of funny, and so nobody really pay attention to what the word is saying. So I wrote this piece during my diploma, my piano diploma, that of course I was not studying, I was just creating, because this is my life, I create and play. And I was creating this piece in the styles of the musician that I was studying for the exam. So you can listen to some Mozart, some Beethoven, some Liszt, they were the pieces that I was studying. So now I welcome the birthday boy, Giuseppe Bruno, on stage to start the program. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
So as the last piece, because I wrote four sonatas, no? It's not going to play the four sonata. But the second movement of the four sonata is, I think, to say hello to everybody, and then I will meet you upstairs for a chat and a glass of wine.
Yes.
Beautiful. Thank you. Yes, this is super. You. Premiere, yes.
To give some breath to Maestro Bruno that played for 1 hour uninterrupted. That's some good effort that you did, Maestro. And I think Patrizia and I felt like Cardinal von Colloredo, the Archbishop, Prince of Salzburg, when he received the compositions that Mozart did for them, and plenty of emotions. I have to say that the first time I listened to my sonata, it was in Roberto's apartment on a Sunday after church, he told me, come and listen to your sonata, and I thought he would play it for me, and of course he didn't. He was cooking for me. It is as important. And he put the score into the computer. I didn't even know you could do that. And the computer played it. And I thought he played it beautifully. And I said, Roberto, why do we need players if the computer plays it? And he says, the computer plays it perfectly, and every single note is played in the way in which it's supposed to be played. But it doesn't have a soul. And I think tonight, Maestro Bruno gave the soul that these pieces have.
The soul of the wrong notes.
even that. Let me say one more thing about the second movement of my sonata, the Valzerino. The Valzerino that many of you might think it's like a 1-2-3, 1-2-3, a light little dance from the Bassa Padana. It's, according to a colleague of ours, and I see Professor Lodizzone back there and Paolo Reni here, esteemed Dante scholars like me, students of Professor Frecero, who said that the 1-2-3, 1-2-3 rhythm, the rhythm of the waltz, is the rhythm that Dante chooses when he writes in the Terza Rima, the Divine Comedy. And thanks to Dante, the whole universe and the celestial spheres go according to the sound of the waltz. 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3. So there is a cosmic and metaphysic beauty to the Valzerino that I particularly appreciated. And I think I gave you enough breath, Maestro, to go back to the second movement of the concerto. We see you upstairs for a glass of wine and to toast to Roberto Scacciella Perino and Giuseppe.